Everyone, this is Mr. Tom Bolton, and we are Sort. We're here primarily to Sort because I think with the DIY principle is we sort of set ourselves up and we very much learnt as we went. We very much sort of taught ourselves sort of both everything from the print aspect through to the business itself. And I think it's kind of relevant in that sense as a small sort of print studio, both working as kind of jobbing printers and as commission work and things like that, is to kind of see how it kind of evolved. So we've just got a little bit of a history and kind of explanation as to how we got where we are and what we do. We went to London College of Printing, and we were both, so that's where we met, and we were studying under Kelvin Smith on a sort of typographic design course. And that's sort of where we first got introduced to both letterpress and silk screening as a sort of print technique. And at that point, digital design and kind of design for two-dimensional sort of screen-based design was very much what most people were sort of leaning towards. And so it was quite left field for us to be sort of focusing on what to a lot of people were essentially dead formats and dead technology. Our final projects that we both did were kind of very heavily linked towards print and kind of book binding and sort of techniques like that. And once we left and we sort of went to the wonderful world of freelancing and things like that, we were quite, we became sort of a bit disillusioned with digital design and the limits of working just as a freelance designer, just doing layout work purely on screen. So we wanted to kind of find a way that we could sort of get back to what we'd enjoyed at college, which was making stuff with our hands and having that kind of the tactile quality of working with objects and actually creating, seeing a project through from beginning to end, from right from your initial sketches through to finishing something that you've actually got in your hands. So we sort of got together and did a little bit of looking around and managed to find bits of equipment and stuff like that online. We picked up our sort of first tiny little Adana 8.5 and a little tiny cabinet with some type in it. And that was sort of the kind of, we just got it basically to kind of play around with and just maybe do our own business cards with, or something like that. Unfortunately enough, we actually managed to sort of speak to Magma Design Bookshop, who I was working with at the time as well. And at that point, they were very much looking to do some gift vouchers, and they wanted to do something that was particularly almost sort of a satirical take on the idea of something that was very over the top and very ornate and kind of fancy. So we sort of somewhat foolhardily kind of agreed to do it and said, well, how about if we letterpress them? And then they would say, okay, we could letterpress them and scan them and then print them out. And we're like, no, we could letterpress all of them. And so they said, all right then, go on, do it. This is the fantastic finished product that we actually did for them. We still produce them to this day. We still supply them with it. It was a learning experience.
Yeah, it certainly was. We've just finished another print run, literally beginning of the week I finished another run of those. We've changed dramatically the way we do them. We started out, that's our first run, with our first Adana, which we got from someone on eBay. Yeah, that looked quite good actually in comparison to what it was really like. It was a matter of hanging them all up. That's my spare room at the time in somewhere I rented. My landlord did come around and view that at that time when I was doing the print work, and he wasn't terribly happy with the drawing room. So obviously in this case we designed it digitally for this and had a plate made. That's a magnesium plate in there. We hadn't had a lot of experience with printing letterpress, and we got the Adana and it's an 8x5 chase, which you think, yeah, 8x5. So I'll design something that's just a little bit smaller than an 8x5 and then I'll be able to print it. Unfortunately, the rollers weren't capable of printing the amount of ink down onto the plate that we needed, so we had to hand ink every single one for the first run, which was agonising to say the least and took forever. And obviously it is a two-colour print twice because the envelopes, obviously, and with very, very tight registration, particularly on the envelopes. And obviously we did, being slightly inexperienced, a full bleed border, which again isn't the best idea because obviously you have to then go and hand cut it all out, which really is really annoying on a hand guillotine going like that. But we've refined our system now. We use one of our main presses now. We cut card differently to the way we used to. It's much more accurate, and we've just refined out everything we do. So we've moved away from being that basic with our first Adana. We still have it, and it still works, and we still use it, and we still bits of pieces on it, which is great, and we've got a few more of them now, and we've carried on collecting. And obviously after that we did some other layout design work for a graphic magazine. In this case we did Hints to Mothers, just sort of a slightly nostalgic view of how children should be looked after, with just some interesting quirky type layouts that we came up with, and just sort of drawing from where we've taken ideas from books and odd music sort of, you know, layouts that were very strange and very bizarre but wonderful in a way. So there was kind of nice bits of type as well. And we then moved on to start doing our own little books, which we thought would be a very good way of A, showing that we can print stuff. It's a good way of practically learning how to do it, and obviously how you produce things. So we started with a range of books called Heed My Warnings, with little things which we feel a bit strange about that people should be maybe a bit more scared about. So we started out with the first one, which we put into little bookshops and sold very well. So we've continued doing them. We've now done 3 of them. We use them initially as promotional material for ourselves, so people can find out what we do and that we are there. We then obviously came up with this thing, actually we can make these and sell them, and we can take them to people and they will buy them, and we can sell them directly, and we can sell them through shops and wholesale them out. May not make a lot of money on those particularly, they are not the best earner. They do make profit, but you wouldn't really do it for the money. That was very much more for just doing it and just putting something out and seeing to people that you can do this, this is what we do, this is what we believe in.
Obviously, I mean, I think it was like, as Michael was sort of saying in the speech, it's sort of, we did it originally just purely because we had a lot, at that point we were focusing mainly on doing commission work, and that was what we sort of saw as the idea, as to sort of where we'd really go with it, because we'd had interest from doing the job for Magma, and because I think at the time we were sort of reading a lot of material about sort of things like private presses at sort of turn of the century, and sort of William Morris and sort of the Doves Press and things like that. We originally thought that if we do this properly, that it will be as commission only kind of thing, and the idea of making products just seemed sort of unrealistic. But because with the Heed books, they actually were quite popular, you know, and that people seemed to kind of really like them as products first, and didn't really think about the fact that we were commissioned to, you know, do work normally, and that we were using it basically as a form of advertising. It was then something we thought, well, actually, yeah, as he said, you know, maybe we can actually do this as a business. Maybe we can focus on products that are achievable, you know, instead of doing purely things that are very high production values, we can also shift it down to making sort of more straightforward things like greetings cards and sort of, and smaller run stuff that we can just sort of spread around to all sorts of different places, instead of trying to keep it more elite or go down the route of sort of particularly high production values. And try and sort of remind people that actually it's quite feasible and it's quite possible to keep letterpress as something that is affordable, that anybody can have in just any old shop. So I think around that sort of point we kind of decided that this is something that we really wanted to proceed with. And that, yeah, after our hilarious experiences with the Adana, that we needed much more equipment and we needed much bigger equipment. And that was the point where basically, yeah, we started kind of looking around to see what we could track down. I mean, we both have printers in our family, so we had a few connections, a few sort of bits and pieces of advice as such as to what to look for, but yeah, I mean, this is this point we started collecting type, and then yeah, we started sort of looking for anything from, you know, sort of local ads through to trawling eBay and stuff like that for equipment, and yeah, that's sort of when we decided that kind of from speaking to other people that plate and kind of treadle presses would be the best sort of suited to what we are after, really. So we started collecting them and restoring them.
So what you see in this picture is a Jean Jardin printing press we got. Sorry, no, that's not a Jean Jardin, that's another one. That's the most recent press we bought. It's very heavy. It's very small, but very, very heavy. When we bought it, we bought that off eBay, and the guy who had it didn't really know and give much of a description, and we thought it would be quite heavy, but it was ridiculously heavy. And obviously the picture on your left is a bit after I degreased it and removed all the gunk that's been on it for over 100 years, and then obviously went to work on taking each part apart, cleaning every bar, every little rod, every cog, every gear, putting it back together, making sure it all worked smoothly, painting it, and then you suddenly have a press which was technically working before, but now technically works at the performance it should be working at and at the speed that it should be working at. And it is incredible how you take something that is basically slightly locked down in its movements. It's very clunky before and very hard, and it all felt like it was working against itself. But then suddenly all the weight that's in it and been put into it frees up, and it's incredibly fast and powerful, that press. Slightly terrifying, as Catherine said, and we've made her well aware of how, how truly terrifying we can be with things. That's the press that Catherine used, and we scared her silly, because on this one it's very light, It's a very easy going press. It was sold originally as being as easy to use as a Singer sewing machine on the weight. It's really not. That's kind of a lie, which often those things are. But again, we bought that not for a lot of money, as in the past you could get these things at reasonable rates, and people understood if they were going to good homes. Obviously, in recent years, it's become much more popular, and the buying now on things such as that in that condition would be very high, and which is why we've always bought the objects that need restoring, because if we don't, we're going up against museums and people like that who are buying them for more exhibitions, or people who want to have them in an office to sort of show off. And we have had offers for equipment or to restore equipment for people. We've never actually done it for anyone else, and we don't really have any plans on doing it, because it's that thing, when you buy machines in that state and want to restore them, every step could be a massive problem and real expense.
It's a labour of love as well. It takes a long time. I mean, I think
that was 3 weeks.
The Jardine, this one, we really got in just a tiny sort of collection of pieces. I mean, that was months. I mean, it took absolute months to kind of get that to a state where we could use it. I couldn't really imagine doing that unless we sort of had the benefit of at least having it ourselves. That was a real lucky find
this,
in many ways.
Yeah, this one was great. It was advertised on a little print website, and it just sort of said printing press, good home, want it to go to, any interest, email. And he sort of emailed him and said, what have you got? Sort of emailed back saying, a printing press, I'll send you some pictures. And pretty much those were the pictures. They're actually slightly nicer than the pictures he sent. And that's us after that was actually on a farm in Tonbridge in a container ship, which was full of water because it was so damp inside. So all the parts were soaking wet and rusted solid, unfortunately. So obviously we gave them, the chap, something for it. We took it back to our workshop down south, which is where I'm based, and we went to work on all the individual pieces. Obviously, as you can see, in the top left, there's two flywheels, which is fantastic, because you think, yeah, I've got two flywheels, not one, so I've got a spare. But that also means that it's got other parts. In this case, this had a lot of other parts for a lot of other presses, all of which I've restored, all of which I don't know what they're for exactly, but they don't go on that press. And I found that out in the difficult way of trying to put it on in different combinations and going, no. Take it off. No, that's nothing. I spent a week on that.
I mean, even there, like in the bottom right, you can see there's like a whole stack of chasers they had that are far, far larger than the actual press anyway. So, I mean, God knows what. There's probably at least about 3/4 of another press that he had in there, but just had no idea what to do with it. So,
but in this case, it was from two rather large gentlemen who was their grandfather's,
yeah.
And he was very stubborn and decided that he was never going to sell it. So he took it apart, kept it in a shed at one point, probably then a garage after that, and then it ended up on this farm after he died, because they didn't know what to do with it, and they tried to sell it to pretty much everybody until they got desperate and started putting it on the internet, at which point we got it.
And then here's the
finished piece.
That's the finished kind of restored version after a lot of time and attention.
Obviously on this one particularly, every part had to be taken apart, literally every screw, every bolt. It had to have some welding done to it, which is, you know, we know a very good welder who actually specialises in doing car parts for vintage cars. But you'd never believe it if you met them. But they are incredibly talented welders who we've used on multiple occasions to see little things like foot pedals can break because they're old and they've had fractures. And lots of machines got damaged at various points and really bad fix jobs were done to them, which is just a shame, because then you have to take them apart and take the welds apart and then rejoin in a way that's more appropriate to the way they should be. But at the end of it, you have a machine like that, which in this one's in Holborn at the moment in our cockpit studio, which is a lovely object and we love, and that you really feel proud of when you're using it, and you feel all that time you spent doing it to restore it, when you're using it, you respect it, which I think is a very key part of what we do, because we use our machines that we've restored with the type that we've collected, and we tend to always remember every little thing where we got it from, and it tends to be odd little people with odd little stories who've got workshops and studios have all done this or done that. It's like we bought a job lot of woodblock off someone recently and went to his house. He was a Canadian chap who was leaving the country, and he used to own a print business and loved print, so he collected all his woodblock but then had to get rid of it, and he'd sold loads of it on eBay to random people, just breaking it down, using it as decorations in their homes and painting it up and sticking it to things and all sorts of lovely stupid ideas. And then I bought one and collected it off him, and he said I was the first person who said he was going to do anything to do a print with it, which seems like a real shame that all this particular woodblock at the moment, which is mad prices at the moment, and if you're going to trade in anything it would be woodblock, but don't. So yeah, that's basically that part. And obviously we've collected a lot of lead type. We did start out with lead type, and we've always collected a lot of lead because it seems more practical for when you're using jobbing presses. It is a smaller print area, whereas if you're using Albions and things like that, you have a bigger thing. So, but the practicality of running businesses and running small workshops is you need jobbing presses, really, because they stand upright. They don't take up a massive amount of floor space. You don't have to get to every little angle on it. You can lean over them to oil little bits and see little things like that. So we've kind of gone down the route of collecting lead type. We've got about 250, 300 trays now, still collecting, still getting offers of type all the time, which is great. And we will tend to always take lead type.
We almost always say yes, but yeah.
Until we run out of room completely or my house is full, we will always say yes.
Nothing wrong with that.
No.
But
exactly.
I mean, I think what's really good about these particular starter press, and this is also like on the right-hand side, this is sort of a large lever press, basically like a sort of oversized Adana that we collected a while back. We don't really use it that much, but it is a fantastic press. And it's good for kind of doing demonstrations and things like that because it's significantly less lethal than the treadle presses. But I think by virtue of the fact that we kind of ended up collecting the plate and sort of treadle presses, because of the smaller print size, it kind of really shaped the way that we were going to go forwards with things. Because we couldn't do larger scale prints and big sort of, you know, A2 size prints. But what we could do is volume. Because I mean, with the treadle presses, you can quite comfortably do like about 1,000 prints a day. So in terms of doing larger print runs of smaller objects, then that suddenly becomes quite feasible, especially like small things like notebooks and cards and sort of personal stationery. So I think at that point we really sort of wanted to sort of push it a bit further forwards. You know, we were both still working in jobs and things like that as well, and that was when we got the offer to kind of get a studio space in Cockpit Arts, which is just in Holborn. I don't know if you know about it, but it's basically kind of a collective where it's geared towards supporting craftspeople. And so it's a subsidized studio space, but you have to be in a craft of some description. And it's assessed by virtue of your craft. You sort of present them with a portfolio of your work and sort of explain what kind of craft work you do. So there's a lot of jewelers and ceramicists, hat makers, woodworkers, everything there. So, I mean, we thought this was like an ideal location for us to have like a second studio space, and especially somewhere that's in central London that we can, you know, meet with clients and things like that. So we applied and we got it. And we also share the same studio space with a restorative bookbinder as well, which is sort of a really nice kind of crossover because we don't really do that much in terms of like sort of full stitched binding, but he does. So we can sort of do a print job, pass it over to him, and then likewise he can sort of pass stuff back to us. This is a shot taken in our actual studio at the moment in Holborn, and yeah, there's our old Adana is sitting on top up there with the cabbage and the taxidermy. And yeah, and basically at that point we kind of decided we really wanted to sort of do it properly. So we massively increased our range of products and spoke to a lot of buyers, did a lot of legwork and a lot of begging of favours and sort of blind mail outs and emails and sending us samples to try and get our stuff into shops. But around this point, this is kind of, sort of about 2-3 years ago when the sort of there is a real resurgence of interest in letterpress and in crafts in general. So I think we were kind of really lucky that we managed to sort of capitalize on that. And so we spoke to a lot of different companies and stuff like that. And these are some of the notebooks we've done and the products that we've made sort of more recently, and they still sell very well. And so we managed to get our stuff into places like Liberty and the Tate, and as well as lots of smaller galleries that kind of specialize in, kind of handmade and individual sort of crafted objects. But I mean, I think the thing that we really wanted to do with our own products, because at the time we were also doing a lot of commission work, and the commission work obviously is a totally different kind of feel to it, but with the products, we really wanted to make the most of what we had. And so we wanted to do everything with our own wood block, with our own lead type, and to kind of restrict ourselves to purely experimenting with what we have in our actual trays. So, you know, in terms of the typefaces, you know, we've got three particular point sizes of one particular face, so we just have to make it work, and we've got to come up with something from that. And I think we're also really intrigued by formats as well, and kind of playing with formats as to kind of doing things that were slightly different, and that made the most of what you can, other things you can do with letterpress equipment other than print. For example, I mean, it is incredibly easy to do creasing work and to do die cuts and stuff like that, which, you know, for digital print is something that you have to usually pay a huge expense for. But for us, we can just get creasing plates and we get a die cutting block made up.
So, insert a brass rule into it,
yeah.
Set the pressure right, it's a creaser, set it exactly. A bit harder, it's a cutter.
So it gives you a lot of flexibility. But yeah, I mean, this is a prime example, really, the stationary sets that we just started doing.
So yeah, these are a product that we've always wanted to do a stationary box set. We had a real problem when we started that we wanted to buy boxes, which were kind of like archive boxes, really nice brown little boxes. We couldn't find any we liked that weren't madly expensive. And people coming up with silly little comments like we have to do tooling on it, and we know fully well what tooling means. It means you're going to turn your machine on, or you're going to go near your machine and start setting it up. Now, at this point, we kind of thought, well, we can't buy the boxes we want. We don't really want to compromise and start using something that's not going to be right for the product, because then we're devaluing our product and devaluing what we do. So at this point, we started thinking, how do we make a box, and how do we make a box in volume, and how far can we go and make a product that can sell, still make us profit, and have something that's really nice at the end of it. So we researched cards, we tested cards, we tested making things with creasing blocks, we worked out how you have to cut it very accurately, because if it's out, they won't make a box at the end of it. If it's not very square at the end of that cutting process, after you've done your first cut, you've got a real problem, because when you go to crease it on a singular crease line, which we do on a very large Arab press, which we haven't got a photo of, unfortunately, because it's always very hard to take a photo of it, because it's right stuck in a corner.
It's huge.
And it is pretty huge, yeah. And very strong, so ideal for creasing, whereas the other presses are a bit, you worry that the pressure can get a bit too high on the joints, or particularly on elderly machines that have got fracture marks from previous fixes. So we hand crease on singular creases, turning each time, and obviously if there's any inaccuracies, it won't work. And we have done that, where you've printed the run, you've done both sides printed, obviously inside colour, outside colour, you make them, you're right at the end point of just cutting the tabs out and sticking them together, and they don't work. And so there's always that accountability that, all right, I made a mistake there, so that's now not going to be used for that. So you keep it, you remember your mistake every time you see it, you use it for packing materials, or next time you do a print, you do your setup prints on it. So it's not really waste. It goes down the chain of being reused lots of times before you really throw it away, and tends to just be piles of stuff really everywhere of going, I will use that eventually because I paid for that card, it cost me X amount, I will use it. And we've now got to the stage where we don't make as many mistakes, but it's yeah. Taken years to get to that point, and we've really trained ourselves to do that.
I mean, I think with this product as well, it kind of like, for us, it was a bit of a sort of a slight kind of key moment in many ways, because we were doing a lot of small products that were quite easy to produce, and so to kind of invest the time and effort and money into kind of producing these, which are higher production value and a lot more effort as well, the fact that they worked was kind of a real boost. And I think, again, it kind of symbolised a lot of the sort of DIY aspect that we kind of automatically just assumed with a lot of it, was that, yeah, we can't find a box that we want, so we'll make our own. Never made boxes before, but we'll give it a go. And then by doing that, you kind of realise, yeah, but then also, if we're making them, we can print them as well. So now we can have printed cardboard boxes that nobody of the people that we spoke to would be willing to do for us, but we've done it ourselves. And so it's kind of that drive to sort of, that through being basically stubborn and kind of being a bit sort of anally retentive about certain details, that actually you can have so much more control. And again, it was around this sort of time last year when we got asked by the London Design Festival to kind of do this pop-up shop event. I mean, it was fantastic. I mean, we were given sort of a whole shop on Carnaby Street for a week and asked to kind of do an interactive event. Originally, we thought we'd just bring like a bunch of Adanas down and stuff like that. But then we thought, we've got to go a bit further. So we actually brought two of the full-size treadle presses, which was quite hilarious to move. But I mean, it was fantastically popular. And it was, I mean, that's the sort of launch night down in the bottom right. But we were really swamped with people, and we had no way of knowing that there would be anywhere near that many people interested in kind of hand printed stuff and just being able to have a go as well. But I think it was really kind of, it's quite heartwarming as well, because especially when you sort of work in isolation, you know, we work with commission clients and we were working with making products to give to shops, and so we sort of know that they're selling because we keep making them to give to shops, but you never really have that contact with people who actually like it, which is quite sort of bizarre. And yet having this, you sort of have suddenly direct contact with lots of members of the public who just want to come in. And some people were sort of full-blown type and print geeks, and they were just obsessed with it and knew all about it. But a lot of other people were completely the other way around and had never really seen it, had no idea that this is sort of how things used to be done. But were still kind of fascinated and enchanted by the fact that, that anybody could have a go and you could sort of learn quite easily. But yeah, and so from that, we got quite a lot of interest, and we got quite a lot of work that sort of came away. This is an immense project that we did with Teresa Monachino. She's, some of you may know her, she's a designer, and she did a book called Words Fail Me with Fiden, which is about the sort of failings of the English language, sort of typographic experiment, basically, all the way through, just in three colours. And she wanted to do a book, basically sort of as an homage to Bodoni typeface. And so this was the design that she'd done, but she also really wanted to have it letterpressed as a sort of limited edition rather than the sort of standard edition that would probably come out through Fiden. So she approached us, and I mean, in many ways, it was kind of a real, a huge learning experience for us, because this is, obviously, this is completely the other end of the spectrum. Instead of being high volume, this has had to be the highest quality we could possibly think of. It was going to be a very, very short run. They're all going to be hand-bound by Rob, our bookbinder friend.
We did the initial binding to bring them together as a...
Cause exactly, as in, certain as in pages, book blocks.
It's full bleed, which meant everything had a border printed around it. They were all made into individual blocks, effectively. They were attached together and then cut as one lump. Again, that's where you realise if you've made a mistake. In this case, the mistake would only be realised at the point after that all the books have been joined together into individual books, and that one of the pages would cut wrong. So obviously, when we did every page in the split between two workshops, we made very sure that those were right, because obviously, if that went wrong, in this case, the paper was supplied by the client who had an agreement with JF Smith for the paper, and that would have been a problem, because then obviously we've used the paper that's been supplied to us. We'd have to then go and buy the paper to replace it, which means obviously our profits would be not as good. But it worked out perfectly in the end. We were very careful. We used all our experience over the other previous jobbing jobs to really make sure we got it accurate. And she was very happy with it, and they've done very well.
I mean, I think, again, it's kind of quite a departure from what we've done before, but it was a really nice experience to be able to do that, and the fact that it kind of almost gone full circle, that we've gone back to doing sort of a commission that is sort of still in volume, but also has the kind of quality element to it as well. Again, this is just some of the other kind of stuff that we do, like VIP invitations to events. We do quite a lot of business cards, which are practically invisible on that screen. We also did, just after Christmas, we did a project with Tate Museum. And this is something that basically the kind of most recent stuff that we've been doing is, again, a nice sort of mix of the two, which is basically where it's commissioned, but to make products. And so the Tate approached us because they were doing an exhibition on Theo van Doesburg. And he did a lot of experimental typography. And so they wanted to kind of have experimental typography as products, as opposed to just the sort of standard kind of, you know, erasers and pencil sharpeners and things like that. So that was a really nice commission to be able to do. And then
very
this
free
was,
as well to do what?
Yeah, exactly.
Just
very,
go
very
away,
slow
think
open.
About it, do what you do, and come back. And obviously, we came up with a lot of ideas. Some weren't as popular as others. Some needed tweaking, but we got there in the end with it, and we produced them all. And they've done well in the shop again.
And this is the most recent thing that we did is in partnership with the South Bank Centre as well. They wanted to commission a whole series of products that basically celebrated the South Bank Centre, either through its origins or through what it currently does. And we went for basically to celebrate the Festival of Britain itself and the reason that the South Bank Centre was built. And so we wanted to kind of keep it. I mean, they asked for the whole idea of it being very much sort of a very British thing, but without being a kind of corny British thing. And so, we kind of took the sort of 50s aesthetic of a lot of the original print material that came with the Festival of Britain and tried to sort of bring it up to date and tried to sort of do something slightly different with it, and something that kind of is both reminiscent of it, but also new and something that is relevant and interesting. I think overall it's quite interesting. I think the thing that we found that is really compelling in terms of doing it yourself is that it isn't really for everybody, that's for sure. And I think it's by virtue of the fact that we are primarily control freaks and very anally retentive to detail, that it's quite suitable. But I think it also, there's a huge amount of freedom there, and there's a huge amount of possibility that you can do with that. And I think, as we were saying the other day, I kind of read an article, they were talking about the interesting thing about a lot of crafts and skills-based stuff is that is the tangible possibility of failure, which I think it's often you're quite a remove in a digital world that there is the ability to pull back from it. And yet with this, the fact that you are relying on your own skills, your own experience and your own knowledge of just having done it many, many times before. And that's basically all that really stands between you and a pile of wasted paper and wasted money, or a pile of products that you have physically handcrafted yourself and are passing on to somebody else. So I think it's definitely I'd rather be doing this than anything else. But I don't know, really. I mean, I think it's been a very long experience for us, and I think it's taken a long time. It's only been within the last 2 years that we can really call ourselves a business. But again, it's not just purely for the money. I think it's just as a way of operating. It's probably the most suitable way for us to do it.
Yeah, we've just worked at what's logical, what seems a sensible way of doing it. Can we do it? How do we sell something? How do we run a business? How do we do our paperwork? Everything has to come basically from yourself. And anybody who wants to do it needs to understand that it's really long and time consuming, and it's a lot of dedication, but it's worth it. And we enjoy what we do, and we love what we do, and we're certainly not giving it up or stopping doing it. And even if we didn't have any work, I'd still have a crummy little job somewhere and just do it in your house or whatever. I mean, it's possible to do any process anywhere, really.
Yeah. I mean, exactly. I mean, you've seen us, we started with an Adana in our bedroom, basically, and now we have two studios. And so it's very much is about, not just sort of the, as we said with the title of the speech, of perseverance and perspiration, but an awful lot of patience as well. Mm. But I think, it's a good way to do it. And I think to anybody who's thinking of doing it, it's worth a shot, as long as you're not expecting particularly quick results. But thank you very much.
Thank you.
We've probably got time for a question for Theo and Tom, if anyone's got a question for them. Yes, Richard at the back. Richard, there's a microphone coming towards you.
Less a question than a piece of information. There is a letterpress demonstration going on based down in the Leighton room and various other bits of the building because the machinery is spread around, but you'll be able to do some of this yourselves today and tomorrow. Mm.
Certainly. Good to have a look. The thing is, to be honest, like, what was it, this week we've been both doing sort of quite massive print runs as well. I think last 4 days I was doing 1,000 prints a day, so... Yeah, but oh yeah, I've got to have a go.
Yeah, question. You've never thought of buying an automated flatten, something like a Heidelberg? You never thought of buying a windmill or a Heidelberg or something?
Think about it, yeah. Think about a lot of things. I think about buying a hell of a lot of stuff, but then I think I've got to put it somewhere, and do I really want that? Is that essential to the way we operate, and how will that help us as a business, and how will that develop us? It's all about taking your time and naturally progressing. It's very tempting.
If you're striving for large print runs,
I mean, we've been offered machines that we could have taken, but it's where are we going to put it? We were offered a typecaster very recently, and the offer's still open, and I'm very tempted. But it's very big, and it's going to be very hard to move, and I haven't got anywhere to put it, apart from my lounge. And I don't think my young lady's going to particularly like that if I do that.
But I mean, I think the other thing was that one of the presses we had been modified to be electric. It had a sort of two-phase motor on it. And it's quite tempting, but I think in some ways, because we got so used to using the treadles, I still like the kind of the physical action of being connected to it through the treadles, and by switching to sort of something fully motorized, like some of the larger Heidelbergs and stuff like that, I think, I was far more concerned about losing my fingers as well, but I don't know, I mean, I think at the moment, the sort of print runs and the sizes that we operate, it's still quite nice to be able to have the control that comes from having just sort of single treadles as opposed to fully motorized ones, but it's... Yeah, if we had the space, we probably would get one.
Or two. Okay.
Any other questions?
On your own Bodoni, have you set type
Sorry?
Sorry?
On the Bodoni.
On the Bodoni one, that was actually, that had to be plate on the ship.
Yeah, that
one. That was a two-part plate, actually, on that one.
Yeah.
Because she was very specific on what she wanted and exactly what part of Bodoni she wanted. We had to go down the plate route on that, which is something we don't really do of our own products, but we do use plates, obviously, for branding. Obviously, like when we did the Tate cards, on the back it's got the Tate logo, which is you have to do, and they want their logo. Mm. So we've worked, realising that, found a good plate maker that works the way we like to work, and he makes great plates, and we can print them beautifully. So some things we do with plates, usually other stuff. Our own products tend to be self-motivated for our collections, which is why we like the collecting. It allows you to be very free. Mm. Often it's not about thinking about the layout too much before you actually just go in and start printing. You often think about colours that you'd like to be in a range and words that you want to be on a card, and you work from there. It's not the usual process of how should I design this? Mm. I've got to design this like this.
I think it's the restriction. I mean, that's quite nice for our own stuff is that we like working with it because you have those certain restrictions and you have the sort of inflexibility of the type, but it also forces you to make different kind of design decisions that, whereas compared to just purely working in, say, Illustrator and then converting it to plates, it's, you lose some of the kind of the certain tactile qualities that we really like of working with original lead type and original picture blocks that are static at a size. I mean, with this whole project, she was a fantastic client because she's wanted to make the most of letterpress with this project. So she was willing to kind of make certain changes and adjustments to kind of that would print better and that would achieve a sort of a nicer effect.
She did a lot of redesigning for
done. Just purely to kind of get it so that it would make the most of the actual format itself rather than just simply kind of sticking with it and insisting that it goes a certain way, even if that kind of wouldn't print particularly well.
And we had multiple options if something didn't work. We did warn her on certain pages. Like the X page is solid black with an X on the middle, and it's a lot of ink. And we did say to her, that might not go well. Mm. And that was a hand ink job, and that obviously affects costs. And we said, we'll do it, and we'll show you if it's, we don't think it's good enough. We will show you, and we will say we don't think this is right for this book. But she's a very good client. She really understood what she was dealing with. She asked us a lot of questions. She spent a lot of time with us to understand that, and with Rob, who did the actual hard binding on it, and to really get what she wanted, and she did get what she wanted at the end of it.
But I mean, that's kind of it's a great project to do, because then you have that real sort of mix of pushing it forwards, of doing something both in a sort of traditional way, but also something completely different, and something that feels very modern by virtue of its content, and yet still it's kind of, it's got the older techniques in terms of how it's produced.
Thank you.
Can I just ask you, when you were rebuilding all those machines, what sort of research were you able to show? Were there manuals?
No. It's very much a jigsaw puzzle. It's just a very large, heavy jigsaw puzzle. Yes, yeah, absolutely. I mean, where are we? Let's go back quickly if we can.
I mean, the principles as to how they work are kind of all sort of pretty much
same logic.
Universal.
Pedal that goes up and down. A counterweight that swings. It's got some sort of cog gearing mechanism. They're all different. They've all got funny little things. This one wasn't too bad. It was in a single piece, which is good. It had some problems with those single pieces, which you have to take apart. There were some fractures in it, which needed to be welded, because otherwise, eventually, they will just snap. And obviously, if that one part snaps, it has a massive chain effect. If one part breaks, it breaks into another, it breaks. And you can suddenly have a lot of parts, and then there's a lot of expense. We've never had actual missing parts. We've been very lucky with not actually missing anything, which is obviously something you definitely think about when you go to buy something, because you look at it and go, oh, that could be lovely. But then you kind of go,
I think it was on this one.
That worried me.
That was the thing we were most nervous of. We just had no idea.
And we went quite a distance to just go and view it. So you think, I want to buy it because I'm here and it's loads of stuff. But if you've got to buy it and think, actually, at that point, they couldn't sell it to anyone. It is effectively just lumps of iron that is effectively, it's got one value, and that is as lumps of iron. So you buy it in the knowledge that it might be missing something. I might have to work out what that is. I might have to design that, and then I might have to have it made. And obviously, if you're having parts fixed is one thing, but having parts made is a whole different world, and that can get very expensive. Fortunately, the welder we use also does make parts from scratch and will design parts for you. And they're just very big fanatics of what they do as well, and they really understand what we do. And they like, you know, they've got a little photo of one of the presses that, yeah, we welded that bit. We did that bit, that's not gone. And they say to you, that might not be strong enough. Do you want me to pin it and I can put bars on it? And you kind of go, yeah, but then it will look really, like you've cut and shut it.
I think it's finding people like that you can work with who are similarly sort of obsessed.
There's loads of people who
slightly nerdy in their own little special fields that are all relevant, really. But again, as I said, it's very much a labour of love. And just a lot of experimentation and just sort of getting a feel of it and experience of sort of knowing that that's probably a certain particular part and that's probably where it goes.
I mean, you can see in the top left, you can see the bar with the spring. We've never had a press with a bar and a spring in it. So you're kind of putting it together and go, wow, what the... Where's that
going? Where will it fit?
It doesn't feel like it's really necessary for the press, but you put it back on it because it's designed to go there. So, and it apparently does help, but if you take it off and use it, it doesn't really help that much. And obviously, that's what happens is you clean every part, you restore every part, even the parts you're not using, and you know fully well you probably aren't going to be using some of the parts, but you do it in case you need it because you don't have to stop just to try it. And then it is literally just a matter of picking things up, trying it, and obviously when they're very heavy things it does really take it out of you, and they're very hard long days when you're trying to drag presses back together. And you know, it's very much a matter of doing a bit, going away, looking at it again, going, that's not right, doing a bit more.
I mean, the satisfaction that comes from when it actually works, when it actually runs, I mean, you know, it's fantastic, you know, to be actually using it, and you know that it's basically running probably in much the same way that it was about 100 years ago or so.
Yeah, and all those little odd fixes really that have been rewarding. Done have been fixed so they're right.
Yeah.
Because there's been a lot of bad repair jobs to a lot of print equipment, which really shouldn't have been done. I mean, there's the peer list that's been dropped on the top. At one point, it had a complete breakthrough on the inking unit at the top, and they just welded it so badly. It was actually, you could see the whole thing was out of alignment, and you kind of go, that's not right. And they changed parts of the inking alignment. In that case, I went online and saw somebody had one advertised because they wanted a part for one. So I emailed them and said, I haven't got that part. I don't know anybody who has at the moment, but I might one day. You never know. Could you take a photo of the inking unit, as many photos as you want, and can you email me them so I can see what it should look like? And obviously, once you've got something that shows you basically what it looks like, you can work from there. And obviously, that was then fixed. So, yeah. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Theo and Tom, thank you.